Welcome back, everybody, to another chapter of A Court of Wings and Ruin, written by Sarah J. Maas, read by yours truly, Freewata, with the exclamation point for the added emphasis. We're back here today with Chapter 10. Last time in the previous chapter, Fyra was ready. Fyra was ready to run away. Get out of here. She had all her information. She was ready to get out. She saw that Yante was trying to have relations without consentation. I was trying to make a cool way to rhyme that, but it's not a cool thing, and you probably shouldn't rhyme it. Yante was trying to rape Lucian, and Fyra used her magic to kind of control her mind, break her hand repeatedly. But we found out at the end of the chapter that Brannig, Dagdon were both watching the entire time. So let's see what happens in Chapter 10. Brannig ran her fingers through Ianthe's golden hair, clicking her tongue at the bloody pulp cradled in her lap. Going somewhere, Fyra. I let my mask drop. I have places to be, I told the Highborn Royals, noting the flanking positions they were too casually establishing around me. What could be more important than assisting us? You are, after all, sworn to assist our king. Time, biding their time until Tamlin returned from hunting with Jurian. Lucian shoved off the tree, but didn't come to my side. Something like agony flickered across his face as he finally noted the stolen bandolier, the pack on my shoulders. I have no allegiance to you, I told Brannig, even as Dagdon began to edge past my line of sight. I am a free person, allowed to go where and when I will it. Are you? Brannig mused, sliding a hand to her sword at her hip. I pivoted slightly to keep Dagdon from slipping into my blind spot. Such careful plotting these weeks, such skilled maneuvering. You didn't seem to worry that we'd be doing the same. They weren't letting Lucian leave this clearing alive, or at least with his mind intact. He seemed to realize it at the same moment I did, understanding that there was no way they'd reveal this without knowing they'd get away with it. Take the Spring Court, I said and meant it. It's going to fall one way or another. Lucian snarled. I ignored him. Oh, we intend to, Brannig said, sword inching free of its dark sheath. But then there's the matter of you. I thumbed free two of the Illyrian fighting knives. Haven't you wondered at the headaches? How things seem a little muffled on certain mental bonds? My powers had tired so swiftly, had become weaker and weaker these weeks. Dagdon snorted and finally observed to her sister, I'd give her about 10 minutes before the apple sets in. Brannig chuckled, towing the bluestone shackle. We gave the priestess powder at first. Crushed Feybane stone. Ground so fine you couldn't see or scent or taste it in your food. She'd add a little at a time. Nothing suspicious, not too much, lest it stifle all your powers at once. Unease began to clench my gut. We've been Damati for 1,000 years, girl, Dagdon sneered, but we didn't even need to slip into her mind to get her to do our bidding. But you, what a valiant effort you put up, trying to shield them all from us. Dagdon's mind speared for Lucian's. A dark arrow shot between them. I slammed up a shield between them in my head. My very bones ached. What apple? I bit out. The one you shoved down your throat an hour ago, Brannig said. Grown and tended in the king's personal garden. Fed a steady diet of water laced with Feybane. Enough to knock out your powers for a few days straight. No shackles required. And here you are, thinking no one had noticed you planned to vanish today. She clicked her tongue again. Our uncle would be most displeased if we allowed that to happen. I was running out of borrowed time. I could winnow, but then I'd abandon Lucian to them if he somehow couldn't manage to himself with the Feybane and his system from the food at the camp. Leave him. I should and could leave him. But to a fate perhaps worse than death. His russet eye gleamed. Go. Made my choice. I exploded into night and smoke and shadow. And even 1,000 years wasn't enough for Dagden to adequately prepare as I winnowed in front of him and struck. I sliced through the front of his leather armor, not deep enough to kill, and as steel snagged on its plates, he twisted expertly, forcing me to either expose my right side or lose the knife. I winnowed again. This time, Dagden went with me. I was not fighting Hibern cronies unaware in the woods. I was not fighting the Ator and its ilk in the streets of Valaris. Dagden was a Hibern prince, a commander. He fought like one. Winnow, strike. Winnow, strike. We were a black whirlwind of steel and shadow through the clearing, and months of Cassian's brutal training clicked into place as I kept my feet under me. I had the vague sense of Lucian gaping, even Brannig taken aback by my show of skill against her brother. But Dagden's blows weren't hard. No, they were precise and swift. But he didn't throw himself into it wholly. Buying time. Wearing me down until my body fully absorbed that apple and its power rendered me nearly mortal. So I hit him where he was the weakest. Brannig screamed as a wall of flame slammed into her. Dagden lost his focus for all of a heartbeat. His roar as I sliced deep into his abdomen shook the birds from the trees. You little bitch! He spat, dancing back for my next blow as the fire cleared and Brannig was revealed on her knees. Her physical shield had been sloppy. She'd expected me to attack her mind. She was shuddering, gasping with agony. The reek of charred skin now drifted to us, directly from her right arm, her ribs, her thigh. Dagden lunged for me again, and I brought up both of my knives to meet his blade. He didn't pull the blow this time. I felt its reverberation in every inch of my body. Felt the rising, stifling silence, too. I'd felt it once before, that day in Hibern. Brannig surged to her feet with a sharp cry. But Lucian was there. Her focus wholly on me, on taking from me the beauty I'd burned from her. Brannig did not see him winnow until it was too late. Until Lucian's sword refracted the light of the sun leaking through the canopy, and then met flesh and bone. A tremor shuddered through the clearing, like some thread between the twins had been snipped as Brannig's dark head thudded onto the grass. Dagden screamed, launching himself at Lucian, winnowing across the 15 feet between us. Lucian had barely heaved his blade out of Brannig's severed neck when Dagden was before him, sword shoving forward to ram through his throat. Lucian only had enough time to stumble back from Dagden's killing blow. I had enough time to stop it. I parried Dagden's blade aside with one knife, the male's eyes going wide as I winnowed between them, punched the other into his eye, right into the skull behind it. Bone and blood and soft tissue scraped and slid along the blade, Dagden's mouth still open with surprise as I yanked out the knife. I let him fall atop his sister, the thud of flesh on flesh the only sound. I merely looked at Ianthe, my power guttering, a hideous ache building in my gut, and made my last command, amending my earlier ones. You tell them I killed them, in self-defense, after they hurt me so badly while you and Tamlin did nothing. Even when they torture you for the truth, you say that I fled after I killed them to save this court from their horrors. Blank, vacant eyes were my only answer. Lyra! Lucian's voice was a hoarse rasp. I merely wiped my two knives on Dagden's back before going to reclaim my fallen pack. Going back. The Night Court. I shouldered my heavy pack and finally looked at him. Yes. His tan face had paled, but he surveyed Ianthe, the two dead royals. I'm going with you. No, was all I said, heading for the trees. A cramp formed deep in my belly. I had to get away. Had to use the last of my power to winnow to the hills. You won't make it without magic, he warned me. I just gritted my teeth against the sharp pain in my abdomen as I rallied my strength to winnow to those distant foothills. Volution gripped my arm, halting me. I'm going with you, he said again, face splattered with blood as bright as his hair. I'm getting my mate back. There was no time for this argument, for the truth and debate and the answers I saw he desperately wanted. Tamlin and the others would have heard the shouting by now. Don't make me regret this, I told him. Blood coated the inside of my mouth. By the time we reached the foothills hours later, I was panting, my head throbbing, my stomach a twisting knot of aching. Lucian was barely better off. His winnowing as shaking as my own. Before we halted amongst the rolling green, and he doubled over, hands braced on his knees. It's gone, he said, gasping for breath. My magic. Not an ember. They must have dosed all of us today. And given me a poisoned apple just to make sure it kept me down. My power pulled away from me like a wave reeling back from the shore. Only, no return. It just went farther and farther out into a sea of nothing. I peered at the sun, now a hand's width above the horizon, shadows already thick and heavy between the hills. I took my bearings, sorting through the knowledge I'd compiled these weeks. I stepped northward, swaying. Lucian gripped my arm. You're taking a door? I slid, aching my eyes towards him. Yes, the caves. Doors, they called them. In those hollows led to other pockets of Prithian. I'd taken one straight under the mountain. I would now take one to get home. Or as close as I could get. No door to the Night Court existed. Here or anywhere. And I would not risk my friends by bringing them here to retrieve me. No matter that the bond between Rise and me. Couldn't so much as feel it. A numbness had spread through me. I needed to get out. Now. The Autumn Court portal is that way. Warning and reproach. I can't get into summer. He'll kill me on sight. Silence. He released my arm. I swallowed. My throat so dry I could barely do so. The only other door here leads under the mountain. We sealed off all other entrances. If we go there, we could wind up trapped or have to return. Then we go to Autumn. From there, I trailed off before I finished. Home. Volution gleaned it anyway and seemed to realize then that's what the Night Court was. Home. I could almost see the word in his rusted eye as he shook his head. Later. I gave him a silent nod. Yes, later. We'd have it all out. The Autumn Court will be as dangerous as summer, he warned. I just need somewhere to hide, to lie low until we can winnow again. A faint buzzing and ringing in my ears. And I felt my magic vanish entirely. I know a place, Lucian said, walking toward the cave that would take us to his home. To the lands of the family who'd betrayed him as badly as this court had betrayed mine. We hurried through the hills, swift and silent as shadows. The cave to the Autumn Court had been left unguarded. Lucian looked me over his shoulder. Looked at me over his shoulder, as if to ask if I, too, had been responsible for the lack of the guards who were always stationed here. I gave him another nod. I slid into their minds before we'd left, making sure this door would be left open. Cassian had taught me to always have a second escape route. Always. Lucian paused before the swirling gloom of the cave mouth, blackness like a worm poised to devour us both, a muscle feathered in his jaw. I said, "Stay if you want. What's done is done." For Highburn was coming, already here. I debated it for weeks, whether it was better to claim the Spring Court for ourselves or to let it fall to our enemies. But it could not remain neutral, a barrier between our forces in the north and the humans in the south. It would have been easy to call in Ryze and Cassian, to have the latter bring in an Illyrian legion to claim the territory when it was weakest after my own maneuverings. Depending on how much mobility Cassian had retained, he was still healing. Yet then we'd hold one territory, with five other courts between us. Sympathy might have swayed for the Spring Court, others might have joined Highburn against us, considering our conquest here proof of our wickedness. But if Spring fell to Highburn, we could rally the other courts to us, charge as one from the north, drawing Highburn in close. You were right, Lucian declared at last. That girl I knew did die under the mountain. I wasn't sure if it was an insult, but I nodded all the same. At least we can agree on that. I stepped into the waiting cold and dark. Lucian fell into step beside me as we strode beneath the archway of carved stone, crude stone, our blades out as we left behind the warmth and green of eternal spring. And in the distance, so faint, thought I might have imagined it, a beast's roar cleaved the land. And that was the end of part one and chapter 10 of Princess of the Carrion. We will be back. We will be back with part two, Cursebreaker, into chapter 11. So y'all, what the heck? What the heck? So you would think Brannock and Dagden, if they were going to poison him, they would have done it with something a little fast acting. I also thought when she had talked about hitting Dagden where it hurts most, I thought she was literally going to talk about kicking him in the nards instead of going for Brannock. I really thought that she had I was like, where is Sarah talking about kicking him there, something like that. And I was like, oh, no, she's going for the twin sister. I get it now. But, you know, I was struggling a little bit towards the end there. Some of the wording started getting a little cross-play with me. Some of the lines were matching up so evenly with some of the words, so I was getting a little disoriented while I was reading almost. But I am excited to see what happens inside this cave, so y'all make sure to stay beautiful, stay hydrated, and we will see you in the next chapter.